Hey guys, it's Ted Bogert. We are back with the Ted Show. This is a repeat. Not really. We tried so desperately to get online yesterday, and I'm so excited we were able to make it happen today. I am honored to have Professor M.S. Rao, or Professor Rao, on the show today. We're going to talk about secrets to achieve your financial freedom. Of course, real estate investments are in there, but he's got so much about leadership and light and doing good in the world and how you can impact the world. And so I'm very, very honored and humbled to have you on. Professor, welcome.
Thank you, Ted, for having me on your show. Hello, listeners. I'm speaking from India.
Yes, and he has been kind enough. It's 9.5 hours difference there or something. Woo! So thank you for being patient. But your story, I feel like, and the message that you put out into the world is so important. So we're going to take a deep dive into that. But first, tell them a little bit about you, your history, your origin. They like to know the journey.
Thank you. Thank you. I was born in a poor family, and I was born in a toxic family and grew up in a toxic environment. And my father had a tea stall, and I was supporting my father in a tea stall, and I used to go to school. And my childhood was very painful and full of struggles and sufferings. My father was an alcoholic and a litigate. My mother is a naysayer. So that's the kind of family I grew up. At the age of 18, I joined the Indian Air Force, that is Indian military, to serve my nation and to support my parents financially. And after I joined the Indian Air Force, when I was 8 years old, I acquired several qualifications. At the time of joining the Indian Air Force, I dropped out from college to support my parents. And after I joined the military life was very tough. Morning 4 o'clock, I have to get up, and night 10 o'clock, I had to sleep. But instead of sleeping at 10 o'clock, 10 to 11 in the night, I used to study. Because right from my childhood, I am passionate about education and learning. At the same time, I am not an intelligent guy. I am a below average candidate. I am a dyslexic with ADHD. ADHD wow. means attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. I had a chaos disorder right from my childhood, and I'm a dyslexic. These were the challenges. At the same
you had lots of challenges, Professor. Did you always know that you were different and going to do different from a young age? Because I grew up in a toxic environment as well. And very early on, I remember, I'm going to do something different. Is that how you were?
No, I never imagined that I will come up to this level in my life. As I told you, I had several challenges since my childhood. After I joined the Indian Air Force, I developed a positive attitude towards life. I started learning about leadership. I have become passionate about leadership. And when my colleagues were taking break, they were enjoying holidays. I invested my time for my education, and I joined at the lowest rank in the Indian Air Force. I acquired 6 qualifications in the Indian Air Force, that is BSc, DME, PGDCLL, PGDBM, MBA, and
you went all the way to the PhD.
Then after I left the Indian Air Force, in the year 2011, I earned my PhD in soft skills. So you can understand that I'm very much passionate about education and learning right from my childhood. This is my strength, actually. And I did business for some years. That didn't work out. Again, I had problem with my father-in-law. He invited me for business. Then again, he backed out, and my brother-in-law backstabbed. That was one more challenge from my father-in-law. So then I joined the teaching field as an educator. And my PhD, became a professor. Then subsequently, I became an author. I have written 60 books so far.
How many?
60 books I have written, but I have published 50 books. And I will show you only 2 books.
Yeah, show us the books.
This is the book on woman leadership. strategies to build women leaders globally. The Vice President of India, Mr. M. Venkaiah Naidu, has written a foreword for this book.
Wow.
I have written this book because I advocate gender equality globally. And I have dedicated this book to three women leaders, Rosa Parks, Maya Angelou, and Oprah Winfrey. I have dedicated this book to three women leaders. So
why
you can understand.
What was the importance for you to focus on women in that book?
Yeah, because women, you know, they have a huge potential. And for many years, you know, they have been neglected. And if women also contribute along with men, we'll be able to build a better world. Because I feel half of the potential and the talent across the world is not utilized. So women have to be empowered. If women were empowered, we would be able to live in a world that is more prosperous and more peaceful. And I have written a couple of research papers on women leadership. I have written articles on women leadership. And I got encouragement when my research paper was published. Then I have written this book on
women leadership.
And this is
you
another
have a second book too.
Yeah,
there it
I'll
is.
Show you. Yeah, this is a book titled See the Light in You, for which the Nobel laureate Dalai Lama has written a foreword for this book. This book is on mindfulness. Okay.
Where did you come up with the title?
Yeah, I came up with this title because people across the world, they have depression, mental illness. They are into rat race. They are searching for stones by leaving gems at home. This is a very big challenge across the world. People in some developed countries, they have money. They are into rat race, but they have mental illness, depression. Divorce rates are rising across the world. So I thought of addressing the issue. So I have written the book on mindfulness. The title of the book is See the Light in You. This is the best-selling book, and this is the most favorite book ever I have written in my lifetime.
I mean, it's first of all, what was it like to get His Holiness to the Dalai Lama to do the foreword? I mean, I'm very, very like in awe of that.
See, whenever I write a book, I write different kinds of books because I'm an experimental author. I don't stick to one particular area. I keep on shifting. For instance, I wrote about soft skills, 6 books I've written. I wrote about soft leadership. Then I wrote about learning, training and development. Then I wrote about students. Then I wrote about executive education. I have written a book on 21 Success Sutras for CEOs. That is one of the best-selling books. So like this, you know, I have written various types of books. Then I thought, why not to write a book on mindfulness? Then I have written this book. After writing this book, then I thought, who is the ideal person to write a foreword? Then a couple of people have come to my mind. Then I approached His Holiness Dalai Lama. He is very kind to write a foreword for my book.
It's amazing the amount of love and support you're giving back, giving into the world. I want people to find you. So we haven't tagged anything on the thing that's scrolling across there, but in all of the posts, I really want you to reach out to Professor Rao and look at all of the offerings he has. This particular topic that we happen to be talking about today, because I'd love to have him come back and talk about light and all sorts of things, is financial freedom. So you put real estate investments in there. So this is a little bit of an offshoot of what we've been talking about, His Holiness and the Vice President of India. So how did the financial freedom secrets come into play, and how does real estate make that happen?
Again, I wrote this book titled, the one which I have told, Real Estate, you know, I have written. I still belong to a lower middle class family in India because of several challenges, betrayals by my family members and rogue relatives. So at the age of 53, I wanted to buy a 2 BHK flat. So I purchased a 2 BHK flat 3 years back. So I wrote all my experiences. how to purchase a flat and how to search the home buyers, how to locate the agents, then how to achieve the financial freedom. All those things I have clubbed and made it into a book, right? So this is the book on financial freedom and real estate I have written. This
so
is
tell us
very,
one of the secrets. That we got a lot of people asking, what's a secret, Professor? What's one of the secrets?
Secret means if everybody knows the secrets, you know, everybody will become a millionaire in this world. Everybody will become a billionaire like Elon Musk, Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, okay, Jeff Bezos, Richard Branson. So the fact of life is that we must follow our passionate areas. That's one thing. And we have to go into those areas only. Whether we achieve success immediately or not, but we still have to keep going in the same direction because we are passionate about that area. And there will be challenges in life, and we have to overcome those challenges without losing focus, and we have to keep moving forward. That's one. Secondly, the real estate is one of the best investments in this world because
yes.
The planet is same, population is growing, so naturally the land value is going will go up. And according to the research, there is growing urbanization across the world. People are migrating from villages to cities. So the real estate will boom and the land prices will shoot up. And there's a huge potential for real estate business. Apart from healthcare and technology, other areas. So I feel real estate is still one of the best options to strike rich, provided you take right care. If you can search the potential areas, underdeveloped areas, if you can identify those areas which are unknown to others, which are likely to shoot up, which are likely to grow, if you can spot that, if you have that business acumen and find out the locations and purchase some lands, then you'll be able to make big and you can strike rich in real estate business.
So a lot of people, when they saw the first promo for the show yesterday, we had a lot of people ask, what is the real estate? First of all, people didn't realize that there were real estate markets in, we'll say, India. So they want to know, because I'm in Florida, right? We're crazy. Our business is insane. It's a booming business, thank God, right now. What's that like in your country?
Real estate in India is not very much organized. There are several legal challenges, and due to lack of literacy, the real estate agents are not well educated, they are not well informed, things are not properly organized. So real estate business in India is booming, but it has got several litigations, land litigations. And that too, India is a country, a very complex country with different cultures, communities. And with the being the second largest populated country in the world, so definitely it's a big challenge for India to overcome all those challenges. We have challenges with agents. We have challenges with litigation in the lands. So these are all the challenges we find in India. Unlike developed countries, in developed countries things are well organized and well streamlined, whereas in India. Still, they are to be streamlined. So it takes time for Indian real estate market to get streamlined. And also government funding is required, government support is required. Some of the Indian entrepreneurs, they have fire in their belly, they are doing good. But again, sometimes the external challenges like COVID-19 has thrown things out of gear. Real estate market was literally out of gear. Not only real estate, all the sectors were literally thrown out of gear due to the global pandemic. Now things are getting back to the track in the post-COVID scenario. Hopefully, India will overcome the challenges and make real estate well organized and well streamlined so that the buyers can buy their flats peacefully without any legal challenges.
fascinating how markets and countries do things or are experiencing different things. I have to ask because of the list. I don't do a lot of research when a guest comes on, but I did read through so much of what you do and have done. So my question to you is, what do you do to regroup, to refuel, to recharge? You're giving, 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 you're talking, you're speaking, you're educating, you're writing. But what do you personally do? Do you meditate, prayer? Do you exercise? People like to know how somebody this much energy recharges themselves.
It's a great question. Nobody has asked me so far, how do I charge myself? I told you, I came from a toxic family, toxic background, so many people have betrayed me. So my life has been a painful journey so far. But I am able to overcome all these challenges because I'm a fitness freak. I take care of my health. I'm very positive by attitude and I keep inspiring the people. I get up morning 4 o'clock and I sleep in the night around 10 o'clock. And throughout the day, I keep acquiring knowledge and I keep writing things and I keep sharing my knowledge freely with the world. So I have created my vision 2030, 1 million global leaders. This is a non-profit one I have created where I groomed more than 40,000 students as global leaders so far. And by 2030, I want to make 1 million students as global leaders.
Wow.
Why I want to make students as global leaders? Because they are the young people. They have huge potential, huge energy. So if they are equipped with the right attitude, if they are equipped with the right mindset, toolset, and skill set, they will be able to grow as healthy citizens. They will be able to grow as global citizens, and they will be able to impact the world. So that is the reason why I started this nonprofit, despite having several financial challenges for the last 6 years. I have a blog, Vision 2030, 1 million global leaders. I keep sharing my knowledge freely. So I am passionate about acquiring knowledge and sharing knowledge. That's one. Secondly, since I have come from a military background, morning 4 o'clock I get up, and morning to evening around 8 to 10 hours write and read. And 2 hours I do physical activities. 1 hour I do workout in the gym. For the last 40 years, I am going to the gym. And 1 hour I go by walk to the gym and come back. I don't have two-wheeler. I don't have four-wheeler. So I'm a very simple man. I still belong to a lower middle class family. But still, I keep doing all these things. Why? Because I'm passionate about sharing my knowledge.
I love that. And that shows... we're going to have you back because we're out of time. That's how fast it goes. One of the things that I loved about everything that you wrote, that it is just so much of the word, so much of the material, really all of it is empowering and trying to help people get over the ledge or take that leap, trying to get people to see that their circumstances are overcomable, if that's even a word. But I love the fact that you just put out so much positivity in the world. And that's why when you agreed to come on the show, I'm like, my audience is going to eat this up because that's what people are hungry for. So tell them the best way for them to reach out to you, to get to your blog, your social media, to buy your books. How can they find you, Professor?
It's very simple. If they can Google my name as Professor M. S. Rao. M for motivation, S for success, R-A-O Rao. If they Google, they can find my social media platforms like LinkedIn, Twitter. I'm available on Instagram. And basically, I'm very strong on LinkedIn because LinkedIn is a professional network. All educated people, professionals are there. So I focus more of my time on LinkedIn. I have a huge presence. And I have a blog, Vision 2030, 1 million global leaders, where I keep sharing my knowledge freely with the world. Okay. Then I have two YouTube channels. If they Google my name, Professor M.S. Rao, they will find two YouTube channels where I have a good number of views. And recently I started the second one, second YouTube channel. So they can find my YouTube channels. They can subscribe to my YouTube channels. They can subscribe to my blog. And they can stay connected with me on LinkedIn. And they can find my books on Amazon. 50 books have been published so far. So still... I have to publish 10 more books. Because of COVID, my books have been held. So hopefully things will fall into track and I'll be able to clear those 10 books also. So they can purchase my books on Amazon. If they type Professor MS Rao Amazon, they can find all my books. This is how I can be approached on social media.
Fantastic. All right. You are just as much of a joy and a breath of fresh air as I knew you would be. You guys reach out to Professor Rao, PhD. It's so important to get involved and embrace our global community. And that's why I love bringing on global thought leaders like you to come on and educate my audience. And I just appreciate all you do. You guys reach out to me if you want to get in touch with him. But the professor here is very accessible and responsive. Thank you for all you do in the world and for being on the show.
Thank you, Ted, once again, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. The way you ask questions, you know, they are open-ended questions that trigger the interviewee to share his or her knowledge. And your audience will benefit a lot from the kind of questions that you ask.
Thanks.
And above all, I appreciate your passion to bring out the best from the guests in order to give it to your audience. So I express my gratitude to you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you. It was all my pleasure. All right, Professor MS Rao, you guys reach out to him, reach out to me. Let's support our global thought leaders. You guys know that you're all hungry for these kind of tidbits and insights. You are a joy. Thank you for coming on. Guys, we will see you back soon. Have a great day.